when I went into the screening of this film, as I walk in, Joel intercepted me in the lobby and said, I know what you're going to say. I know what you're going to say. But trust me, with all the ad libs and the craziness, you were there in Rome. We had two test screenings. The audience didn't know which end was up. So the only way to make it work was to put this narration over the opening scene. So to put you in some perspective here, I'm assuming that the people like listening to this are familiar with the picture. In a way, this is a riff on Goldfinger. The villains in this movie want to do exactly the same thing what Goldfinger did, which is disrupt the value of gold in the world, and they will be the only people to have real gold, which was what Goldfinger was going to do. Now imagine if there was an opening over the opening scene of Goldfinger, where Bond has the duck on his head and is in the scuba diving suit. If a narrator said, "Auric Goldfinger intends to rob Fort Knox, to break into Fort Knox to irradiate it," so that you're like, and that's what's going on here. That in the original script, which had the same opening scene here, we saw with the same Italian dialogue, Da Vinci looked off and said, "Oh my God. Oh no, oh no." And we didn't know what scared him, right? And then he looked around and he hid the three pieces of the master. In mine, it was gears rather than prisms in the script. And he hid them, but we didn't know what startled him. And you did not know until the analogous point in Goldfinger, I'm making this up, but if Goldfinger's 110 pages long, I guess about page 81, like right before the airplanes fly over, he admits what's really... So that's what was going on in here. So I just groaned that. So now you have no curiosity whatsoever in the audience's mind of what's going on. Your hero looks stupid because he isn't figuring it out. Everybody looks stupid. And the whole thing is a stage wait.